Okay, so thank you, Fabien. Hello, everyone. So I will present you my work about the generalization of the cRPA scheme and the implementation and use of this new scheme in a minute. And this scheme has been used to assess the role of interaction on oxide p orbitals. So this work has been done at the CEA under the supervision of Bernard Hamann. So first to introduce. What's the problem? So I plot a density of states of xenon dioxide computed in GGA and compared to an experimental photo emission spectra in green. And so in black, we can see the total density of states. And it's clear that the GGA wrongly describe the insulating character of xenon dioxide in GGA, so and not splitting the F band in two parts to have an insulating material, and so a few methods have been developed to overcome this problem in DFT, such as DFT plus U or DFT plus DMFT, and all these methods are based on the fact that strongly correlated electrons are located on specific orbital on the system. In most cases, d and f electrons, and this method explicitly take interaction, take electronic interaction into consideration, but only inside this orbital, not on all the orbital of the system. And this interaction can be treated statically or dynamically in DFT plus U or DFT plus DMFT. Both those methods use two parameters, which is U and J parameters. And so here to compare is a GGA plus U with a U of 5 electron volts, and it's compared to the same experimental photo emission spectra. And you can see that now the F band in red is splitted in two parts, and one below the Fermi level and one above. So we have an insulating material. That's what the experiment gives us. But you can ask why did we take 5 electron volts, and so it's the main problem of here. So how to obtain the U we use in our GGA plus U or DFT plus U in general calculation. So the first thing we can think of is to experimentally fit the U on some characteristic of the system, such as cell parameter or band gap. But it limits our number of systems to only the one where we have some values of band gap or cell parameter, and it's not really a first principle way of calculating those parameters. So it's not a good calculation scheme. And so the second way to have a U is to calculate it. So two main methods exist nowadays, which is first the constraint NDA. That assess the change in energy of the system with the change in the number of electrons on the system. And the second one, which is the one we use, is a constraint random phase approximation. And so what's the cRPA? So the cRPA has been developed in the early 2000s, and it's based on the calculation of a screen interaction between correlated electrons. And in order to do that, it used the RPA scheme. So the RPA represents screening by electron hole transition. And we separate our screening in two parts. So first, chi0 correl, which is the correlation, the screening due to correlated electrons, so only inside the correlated band, and the rest of the screening. And the cRPA remove the screening inside the correlated band to only use the screening of the rest of the system. And so once we have done that, we can calculate our interaction between our correlated electrons screened by all the screening of the system except the screening inside the correlated band. And in order to do that, we use what Bernard presented to you before, which is a projected localized orbital of a function of a meat. And so now what's my work? So one work was to enlarge the cRPA scheme to make possible the calculation of many effective interaction per system in one calculation only. So for example, in uranium dioxide, before we computed only one interaction, so most of the time it was a UFF, so the effective interaction of F electron in the system. And now we can calculate many interactions, so both F interaction p interaction, but also inter-orbital interaction, so UFP. And in order to that, we use the module that Bernard talked about, which is a separate module in Avinit, which is a Plovany module, and we introduce a new data type to store our data. So first, what's the new scheme? The new scheme. So before we remove the screening inside the f orbital to calculate an interaction of the f electrons, and now we remove all the interaction in both our orbitals, so inside p orbitals, inside f orbitals, and between p and f orbital. And with by bringing that, we are able to calculate the interaction of all the electrons. So the big matrix here, which contain all the interaction of between two electrons, with the screening that is only removed on a few inside the correlated orbitals. So this bit, to calculate our value of U, we just take the mean value of our matrix with projected on two different Venn functions that can be the same or that can be different. But it raises a new problem because it's in the old implementation, our U matrix, the big matrix, was a square matrix because as it was the same atom and the same orbital, our M value, so the little M quantum index, was between minus L and plus L. So for example, for your F orbital, we have seven indexes. And so we have a 7x7 matrix. But now, as we have two different, as we can have two different atoms or two different orbitals or both of them, we cannot have a square matrix, and the dimension of our interaction matrix depends directly on the value of parameter in the system. And so, in order to be able to calculate this interaction matrix, we make use of nested data types. But unfortunately, the use of nested data types dramatically slow the compilation on Intel compilers, but only when we try to optimize the code. So we have introduced a new preprocessor macro, which is cRPA Optim with the help of Matt O'Donnell, in order to deactivate by default the optimization of cRPA routine. But and we can activate them by precising this cRPA macro. And so here an example of a calculation with the new implementation. So first here is an example of the old implementation. So those four values can be accessed by four different calculations. In reality, we have only three values because the pp orbital, so pp interaction, so interaction between two electrons on the p orbital, on the p orbitals, are the same on both atoms of oxygen. So those three interactions have to be calculated with three different calculations. And in the new implementation, with only one calculation, we can calculate all these interaction matrix. So all these values are the values of two electrons interacting with each other. So again, in this big matrix, we have only few new values that are interesting. So here are the inter-orbital calculated values. So for example, the FD is the interaction between one electron on the F orbital and one electron on the D orbital of the uranium. And here the FP is the same with one F electron and one P electron. And the PP prime is the interaction between two electrons located on two different oxygen atoms. So all those values are not really usable in a LDA plus U or GDA plus U calculation because for now, the inter-orbital integration, the interorbital interaction is not taken into account in a GG in a LDA plus U or LDA plus GFT. But with our new scheme of cRPA, we were able to reproduce some results from the literature, and we are really close to what has been calculated before. And there was an article that was published early this year about this new calculation. And so. Our new implementation is available in Avinit since the V9, so since the beginning of this year, I think, and it makes use of the Plovan module, which increases modularity of the code. And with this generalized cRPA screening, cRPA screening, we can improve the description of some system with p orbitals. And the perspective is to assess the impact of this UPP on cRPA. So what does an interaction on p orbitals, what role has this interaction on the bond structure, and to do full consistent GFT plus UFF plus UPP cRPA which is the goal of this implementation. And in the future, we will try to implement the DFT plus U with Van function to overcome some problem with localization of the electrons. And so thank you for your time, and if you have any question, I'd be glad to answer them.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Vincent. I think we have a question from Michel Coutet. Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Can you read it?
Mm-hmm.
Did you say that you cannot calculate the J? So this is
yes. In reality, we cannot calculate the J in the interorbital calculation. Why is that? Because I think if I take back here. Here is the U matrix, but in order to calculate the J value, I don't remember yet, but I think the J way of calculating it is to have a value on. It's an implementation problem that is a bit difficult to explain here, but. The J value is used on a different Venier function that are not located on the same place on the code. So when we make use of one interaction, the other interaction that is used to calculate the J is not located at the same place. So we cannot calculate the J. It will be technically possible, but it requires some other implementation. And as in DFT plus U, we don't make use of interorbital interaction. There is not really any advantage to calculate that.
Okay, there is a couple of questions by Eric Bousquet. So he wants to know if you need to recalculate the U if you change the position of the atoms.
Yes, it's needed to calculate. We don't do relaxation. But a scheme has been proposed with DFPT and constrained NDA. And in their all the schemes, they relax, then calculate U, and then we relax with a new U and that self-consistently to have a self-consistent U with the relaxation. But yeah, U depends on the position of atoms.
Okay, now maybe we can go to the question of Niels.
Yes.
He asks about if you can combine this with the MFT.
I'm not an expert in DMFT, but in DFT plus U, for now, we can do not interorbital, but with two different atoms. So for example, we can do DFT plus UFF plus UPP. So one U on the F orbital, one U on P orbital, but no U between F and P. And this scheme have been used, and it's not really more difficult than standard DMFT or standard DFT plus U. So it's possible, but the big implementation is interorbital interaction. That's the blocking point for now.
All right. So thank you, Vincent. I think we are done with all the questions that were in the chat.
Thank you.